Ready, give it to go. Terence, you first.
Accio.
Good. Bailey.
Accio.
Very good. Luke.
Accio.
Wonderful. Now Gretchen.
Accio.
Excellent. Now all together on the count of three. One, two, three.
Accio Hogwarts Radio.
This is Hogwarts Radio, episode 235 for February 24th, 2019. Hogwarts Radio is the official podcast for wizarding news from HPANA, discussing all things Harry Potter, Fantastic Beasts, and the rest of the wizarding world. For the quickest up-to-date news on the franchise, make sure you check out wizarding.news. Hello everyone, and this is Hogwarts Radio, broadcasting to Harry Potter fans worldwide since 2008. I'm Terrence Pinkston.
I'm Bailey Riddle.
I'm Gretchen Rush.
And I'm Alex Lohman.
Our show can be found virtually anywhere online, such as iTunes, the Google Podcast app, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Radio Public, and other places where podcasts are aggregated. It doesn't matter where or how you listen, just make sure to tap the subscribe button, and we guarantee you'll have a new episode each Sunday.
We also invite you to follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, so you never miss an update from the show.
You can also send an owl to staff@hogwartsradio.com, letting us know what you think of the show. You never know, you might just end up on the next episode.
Don't forget, Hogwarts Radio is also on Patreon. By pledging, you'll have instant access to many benefits, including Into the Common Room, behind-the-scenes planning of the show, Hogshead Radio, and much more. Sign up today over at patreon.com/hogwartsradio. Welcome to episode 235. We're alive because we feed our Potter addiction here just one episode at a time. But we're glad everybody's joining us this week. And Bailey, welcome back. It's been a couple of weeks.
I feel like this little hiatus was just what I needed to refresh myself and get back into it.
So today's kickoff involves memory charms and specifically modifying memory charms and Veritasierum. So what happens if someone's memory is modified, you know, much as Hermione knows how to do and Gilderoy Lockhart, so on and so forth, and then they take Veritasierum? Do they tell the truth as they remember it, or do they tell it as it actually happened? Is this one of the ways the effect of memory charms could be reversed?
I don't think so. I had like the biggest inception like moment thinking about this, where my brain just kept going in circles about like, where does it start? Where does it end? I don't know. But if someone modifies your memory, the only truth you know at that point is the modification. And from what I recall, like, memory modification charms are incredibly powerful. And I know Veritaserum is also very powerful, but it's kind of like a clash of what overpowers what. But my gut logical reaction is you would just remember your memory as it was modified. I don't know. Maybe that's too simplistic. I really struggled with this all day long. I would just like to put that out there.
People are losing sleep over this question.
I think I agree. I mean, if you don't remember something, how can you be honest about it? You can only be honest about what you know.
Yeah, I agree with that. I also think it might be, maybe it comes out skewed. Maybe it's the type of thing where I just watched an episode of Stargate SG-1 that had similar themes, where the memory was modified. And so he thought that he had committed the murder, but then when they looked at the memory, it showed that it had been modified. So maybe it's the type of thing where your memory has changed and you take the Veritaserum, so you spit back out what has been told to you, your new memory, but it's not exactly right and things sound off and there are like gaps. And so you can maybe tell that the memory has been modified.
Wow, that's very interesting. I hadn't thought about that before, of there being just gaps in the memory, because there's let's face it, I mean, we all go through those kind of things where like, oh, you just don't remember, you know, you can think back as hard as you can, but it's just something that your memory can't recall. It can't bring it up. Like, you heard a song somewhere and you don't know what it was, where you heard it, but you know that it sounds familiar. I think that's probably pretty accurate.
Well, that's a good point, because I wonder too with Veritaserum, like, if you ask me, what did you do on September 1st when you were five? I don't remember, but is it, will my brain trigger the memory because you've used truth serum on me? I feel like memory with Veritaserum is a whole different realm that I don't really know how to address.
It's kind of like the ultimate brain fart. I mean, in terms of like trying to assess like what overcomes what. Although I do love your point in terms of like, if you gave someone Veritaserum who had had their memory modified, there would obviously be like certain lapses. There'd be certain like cognitive dissonances, like in retelling a memory that just wouldn't make sense. That would make it fabricated. So there'd be like some evidence to it, but there would be nothing more.
So what about, we know that it works on witches and wizards and muggles. What if you had, for example, a muggle that had Alzheimer's or dementia and you gave them truth serum? What do you guys think would happen? Would they be able to recall, you know, certain events or certain memories if you asked them a question?
We're kind of on that same idea. Like, could you use Veritaserum as almost like a treatment for those diseases?
Right, exactly. Exactly. I mean, that's the thing with Veritaserum and memory is like, is this one of the ways, because we know that there's very complex ways of fixing memory charms, you know, of like kind of erasing the work that you did. Presumably what Hermione had done to her parents after the final battle, you know, she went and found them and just reversed her work. I wonder if like this is one of the ways with Veritaserum, like that's a step that that you have to take.
So Joe, if you're listening, because we all secretly hope that you are, we want to know essentially if Veritaserum has like regenerative qualities, if it could like rehabilitate, you know, what it transpires in the brain through Alzheimer's and dementia and whatnot, because it would essentially be asking to repair what has been damaged or modified. And I think that's kind of the crux of the debate here is, are we assigning it more power than it actually has from what we know from the books? Or is it just a truth as you know it? Spill your beans.
Well, that's one way to get the show going. That's one way to get the wheels turning in your head. it's been a pretty busy week on the news front. We've had a couple of things come out, and you know, last weekend on the digital version of Crimes of Grindelwald came out, and we have a little bit of news centered around Fantastic Beasts 3, right, Gretchen?
Yes, we do. And it's less news, more speculation, I guess. So I'm curious to hear what you guys think about this. So we already knew that they pushed the filming start for Fantastic Beasts 3. They were supposed to start in the summer. Now they're going to start in the fall. And they said that was because it's going to be bigger. They need more time to plan, yada, yada. And also, I realized that Catherine Waterston is pregnant, and that was announced recently. So that probably also had to do with the delay of filming. So whatever, that all makes sense. But now Warner Brothers has announced the release date for an upcoming big budget picture, Dune. And that movie will be released on November 20th, 2020. And Crimes of Grindelwald was released November 16th, 2018. The first Fantastic Beasts film was released November 10th, 2016. So it would kind of make sense that somewhere around November 20th, 2020 is when we were supposed to see the third film. So now with the announcement of this big budget movie, I'm wondering, are they going to push it to 2021? Because I can't imagine that they would be putting marketing efforts toward the third Fantastic Beasts film and Dune if they had similar release dates. So what do you guys think about this?
I think that makes a lot of sense. You don't see production companies that are trying to release massive pictures at the same time in any given like season. So I think by pushing it, they're not only giving Dune its time because it's probably going to be ready, they're giving themselves extra time to really fine tune and hone things and make sure that they're going to put out the best picture possible.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to echo that with Bailey. You just don't see two big budget films from the same studio out around the same time. That's just, I mean, unless they want to have a stellar holiday season, which they could possibly push Crimes of Grindelwald up to, you know, push it up to December of 2020, or if at all possible. And I don't know if we've gotten news about this, but maybe if they push Crimes of Grindelwald, maybe if they push Fantastic Beasts 3 back to July 2020.
Or maybe May, because May was a big date for the Harry Potter films as well. Half of them were released in November, and then I think like one was released in July and the other half was released in May. So that's a possibility.
I mean, it's it, they're certainly trying to approach this in a different way that they approach Crimes of Grindelwald. They saw that November didn't work for them. Now that, you know, people take vacations in July or, you know, in May, they're out of school, they're out and about, they're seeing movies. I would think that's a smart move, or worst case scenario, it's possibly pushed to 2021.
I'm stumped only because of just the mixed results that Crimes of Grindelwald received and kind of a lot of the speculation we can read into this. I do think it's kind of smart, though, for the franchise to kind of think about shaking it up, especially after Fantastic Beasts really did not land very well, whether it be in the November time slot where kind of like all the big blockbuster like holiday movies are coming out. Whether, you know, it be in terms of taking the extra time. The podcast has kind of speculated before that maybe they're taking the extra time to really revisit the script, get more of Joe's input on it. I don't know, but I think while the fans might all of a sudden be an uproar, because that's not, you know, without historical precedent, I'm kind of encouraged by it. Because I think it's something that Fantastic Beasts needs. It needs a little retinkering after the last movie, in my opinion.
Yeah, the last movie made a total, as of today, $652 million. That's both, I mean, that's domestic and international numbers combined. Right now, at least I know in my area, it's out at the dollar movie theaters. So it's not going to crawl much higher to that. I doubt it'll even make $660, which is an incredibly low amount for this franchise and a film. What is this news tell us about the future of the franchise? Are they trying to take care in pushing it and give Jo enough time to revise a script, if that's in fact what she's doing? Do they not have any confidence in starting out the 2020 decade with a big blockbuster such as a Wizarding World franchise movie? Or, you know, I don't know what Warner Brothers is thinking about the future of these movies.
I don't know either. And I'm wondering too if there's more to this, because they never said that November 2020 is when the third one would come out. So I'm wondering if maybe they had never planned on that. And it was just assumed. Maybe they were always thinking, oh, we'll give it a bit more for the third one because it's going to be bigger. It's going to be, you know, it's a third in the series. There's out of five, that's a big deal. We're right in the middle. Maybe we want to do May 2021. And they've always been thinking that. So we just don't know. And we haven't gotten any official word from them about Fantastic Beasts. All this speculation is coming from an announcement about Dune. So I'm really curious to see. I hope that they hear this speculation and decide to make an announcement.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with that. It's just there's pieces to the puzzle that are missing. So Warner Brothers, please fill us in on that.
We await your owl. In the meantime, let's talk about a super cool costume. So WoW Stuff has released an invisibility cloak costume, which is awesome. The costume is capable of making it look like anyone or anything has disappeared right before your eyes. So you download an app on your phone, and then you enter a code that's included with the costume, and then the two work together using WoW Stuff's Metachrome green screen technology to allow you to watch your body vanish, which is so, so sick. And this is going to hit stores July 1st. So it's kind of funny that they're calling it a costume when it's coming out in July, not necessarily for Halloween. But I would wear this pretty much anytime. I would wear this to conventions. I would wear this down the street. It sounds super sick. What do you guys think?
When I read the description for it, I was like, holy shirtballs, that's so cool. Especially like how the technology behind it is going to work. Because like, I was maybe 13, I think, when the first movie came out, and they have the whole bit with the invisibility cloak. And I was just like, oh my God, I want that. That is the coolest thing ever. And so it'll also be interesting to see, like, as kind of Harry Potter gets its, I don't want to call it like second wave of momentum, but like, I think I talked about this last time, as the like OG Harry Potter fans procreate and their kids are going to be indoctrinated in the world of Harry Potter, it'll be so fun to see like how the younger fans are going to take to this too. But I loved that one of the designs is like going to come with like essentially like a film replica with all of like the detailing that we see from the films. And that's just super cool, just from like a super fan standpoint. That I would definitely invest in.
I think it's neat, but I don't see this as being something that like I would ever get regular use out of. It's more just like, oh, hey, this is a fun party trick. And that's the extent of it. And I don't want to invest that kind of money for something that I'm going to use maybe a handful of times.
So I'm kind of confused about this. Is this, one, a personal cloaking device? Because I could see real trouble with that. Or is this like, oh, something you put on and then you kind of like take a picture and it shows like nothing, like you're invisible? Is that what this is?
It sounds to me like you put it on and then you pull up the app and you point that at yourself, almost like a filter type thing, and then it makes you look like you're invisible through the phone.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that seems pretty cool. But yeah, I'm going to have to agree with Bailey. I don't see myself using this like all the time.
You're not going to wear this down the street with me?
I've already worn my Gryffindor cloak in San Francisco, walking down the street with that. I think I've had enough fun.
That's fair enough. But anyway, if you aren't in grabbing that, that will be out July 1st, just in time for your Harry Potter birthday parties, I guess.
Thank God it'll be out before Fantastic Beasts 3. Jeez.
It'll be out long before Fantastic Beasts 3. Don't worry.
I was really sweating that. Yeah.
We can all wear them to the movie.
Oh, good.
We invisible seats.
Why did no one show up to this movie, you guys?
Got him. All right. Speaking of Fantastic Beasts, let's talk about a Crimes of Grindelwald deleted scene. This scene was not available to watch, but I have the text. So it's a conversation between Newt and Dumbledore. It's kind of the extended conversation about Dumbledore revealing to Newt that he sent him to New York, or revealing to the audience that he sent Newt to New York. So Newt asks him about it. He says, "So why did you send me to New York?" Dumbledore says, "Because I knew Grindelwald would try to catch Credence. He had a vision, you see, many years ago, in which an Obscurial killed the man he fears above all others." Newt says, "You." Dumbledore says, "I thought you might deprive Grindelwald of his weapon, not by killing Credence, but by saving him." Mm-hmm. What do you guys think about this extra little tidbit?
Yeah, there's a couple of pieces of information unpacked from this. Number one, who does Grindelwald fear above all others? I don't think he fears Dumbledore.
That's what Newt thinks.
Well, Dumbledore never confirmed that. You say, Newt goes, "You," and unless there's like something where Dumbledore nods and he goes, "I thought you might deprive Grindelwald of his weapon," yada, yada. You know, he doesn't really, there's no confirmation of that. But that's very interesting. That's the first thing I thought whenever I read through this. I was like, hey, who does Grindelwald fear?
Yeah, I had the same thought. It like sounded oddly too much like Dumbledore talking about Voldemort, essentially. And so I was like, God, that tracks too closely for me. And to Terrence's point, he doesn't confirm it in true like sly Dumbledore fashion.
I think the most interesting thing to me is the Grindelwald had a vision part in which an Obscurial killed the man he fears above all others. So I like what you pointed out, Terrence, about we're not sure exactly who the man is, but I'm also interested in this vision. So we know that Grindelwald has these kind of prophetic things. We see him show everyone the vision of World War II at the end of Crimes of Grindelwald, but I'm wondering how frequent that is. Do we know more information about that?
He's a seer, right? Grindelwald's a seer? We learned that? God, I want to say I heard that somewhere and it was considered canon.
I feel like they didn't go into it very in depth in Crimes of Grindelwald, so I don't remember much about that backstory, and I'm wondering like how many visions does he have? How often does he have these and how accurate are they? Because we know that an Obscurial doesn't kill Dumbledore. We know how Dumbledore dies. So does he have visions that he is then able to prevent? Because he doesn't prevent World War II from happening. We know that for sure.
Does he want to prevent World War II from happening?
He didn't succeed in the other one that he did want to prevent from happening.
Well, yeah. I mean, that's true.
He didn't want to prevent from happening. I'm confusing everything now. Well, anyway, let's move on to our next bit of news. So there's a new Wizards Unite trailer. The trailer features an adorable Niffler raiding an arcade game. Here's an excerpt from the official Harry Potter Wizards Unite website. A Niffler has been spotted at a Muggle amusement arcade, no doubt drawn in by the irresistible flashing lights and jingling of coins. While several Muggle children happen to witness the Niffler's antics, they thankfully seem to have mistaken it for one of the many plush and mechanical toys.
Yeah, I saw this. This is cute. This is really cute. And I can't ever go to an arcade now and not see one of those machines and not think of a Niffler inside of this. gosh, guys, just this game in general, the response to this game is going to be so massive. Remember the insane amount of Pokemon Go players that we all saw out a few years ago? I mean, in your local communities, like, you have people walking in parks, like, people you could have lived in your area for 10 years and people you have never even seen before. And they're going, trying to catch all of these Pokemon. And to this day, Pokemon Go still has these parties. I forget what they're actually called, but where people actually go out in groups and battle and catch Pokemon. I think about this time last year in Chicago, there was one infrastructure totally crashed. The servers crashed and, you know, they weren't able to actually do what they wanted to do. But there was like 20,000 people there around Millennium Park just to play this Pokemon Go game. Now, imagine the same thing with Harry Potter fans getting dressed up in robes and other Potter gear and going out in droves of crowds to play this game.
I just have a very strong image from Sorcerer's Stone, and I believe it's the first chapter, when Joe's describing everyone celebrating and Mr. Dursley's like looking in on people and being like, why are they dressed so funny? What are they doing? What are they celebrating? When you're describing like Harry Potter fans coming out in throes for this game, I'm like, oh, it's that scene from Sorcerer's Stone.
Yeah.
Which is just wonderful. On the point of the trailer, though, I think my best or the best part for me is they show the Niffler like in the coin game. And if you've been to an arcade, you recognize that game immediately. But they show him as like being drunk on coins. Like he gets the hiccups and then he just like spews more coins out of his like little pouch. And I just thought that was hysterical. I'm like, oh, he's drunk from his treasures.
It's cute. And I don't think that's an effect that we've ever seen have on the Nifflers before. Like, Niffler doesn't quite get his entire fill.
No, he doesn't.
Yeah, and I think...
Oh, go ahead.
I think that just imagining a Niffler having so much treasure that he can't even handle it anymore is just the cutest thing ever.
That's adorable, isn't it? You guys excited for the game? I know I am.
I am so ready to plan some like LA meetups, especially just like imagining planning a meetup in the theme park and having all of these people dressed up more so than usual at the theme park, like for a purpose.
Yeah.
Sounds like so much fun to me.
I imagine there's going to be so many meetups in Orlando for that same reason. And I'm like, 2 hours south of Orlando, and I would for sure drive up for that. I'm just excited that maybe it'll work out a few kinks from their first go at video, at like phone app based video gaming. Because in all candor, I gave up pretty quickly because I was kind of frustrated. I was like super jazzed for like the first week, and then I was like, this is fun, but also frustrating. So I'm excited to see what they do here.
So we've been seeing more and more marketing for this game, more and more little spots and trailers and things like that. Are we close to a release date?
I really hope so. It's got to be coming soon because they've already pushed it. Weren't we already supposed to have gotten this?
Yeah, we were supposed to get it in last part of 2018.
Boo.
And hey, if they're pushing it to... you know, to fine tune the game and make sure like they got all the bugs worked out and stuff like that. More power to them, please. Like, put out a solid product. I wonder if they're going to be beta testing it.
I was just going to say that. Like, Bailey, why aren't you beta testing this?
I mean, if they want to offer it up to me, I am more than willing to test it out for them and let them know what I think.
Yeah, if there's a representative from Niantic, right now listening to the show, please email us at staff@hogwartsradio.com so we can get an early access to the game. We can review it, we can let you know how we like it, all that other stuff. Watch, we get an email like tomorrow morning, stop talking about it. All right, Gretchers, what else we got going on?
We got one last piece of news here. So USAopoly, who releases a lot of Harry Potter games, they are releasing a couple more this year, which I'm super stoked about. And they will include Scrabble World of Harry Potter, Harry Potter Defense Against the Dark Arts, and a third unnamed cooperative game. Scrabble World of Harry Potter allows you to play Harry Potter character names, places, spells, and potions, in addition to traditional words. You can also rack up extra points by completing directives from special Harry Potter cards. Harry Potter Defense Against the Dark Arts, meanwhile, was inspired by the popular Harry Potter Hogwarts Battle, which I have. It is a two-player competitive deck-building game that gives you the chance to square off one-on-one with your opponent. Learn offensive and defensive spells to protect yourself and stun your dueling partner in a fast-paced fight to the finish. The third game has not really been announced yet, but is supposed to come out a bit later this year. So I'm super stoked about all of these. I have a lot of USAopoly Harry Potter games, and I've played a lot more of them. I played the recent like Fantastic Beasts one at a convention, and I've played a bunch of other ones. So these all sound sweet. I'm really excited. What do you guys think?
Unfortunately, I'm not the subject matter expert here, so I'm going to have to defer to the other members of the panel on this one.
So they sound awesome. And I have the deck building game, which I do love. It's very fun. And I have the Trivial Pursuit. But the only beef that I take with the Scrabble when you were just reading that is, you know, they're like, oh, Harry Potter character names, potions, spells, whatever. Like, in true Scrabble tradition, aren't nouns discounted? Can't you not use nouns and like the I think it's nouns. And so part of me is like, isn't that kind of cheating? But I also get that eliminates like a solid, you know, the third to almost half of the Harry Potter vernacular that you could use in Scrabble. So I get it. But the Scrabble, like, originalist, wow, I sound like get off my lawn again. But the Scrabble originalist in me is like, hey, now we got to go back to the true version. But I'm super excited because I love board games. I love Harry Potter. Mash them up. I'm there. I'll buy it. So even if I have my gripes, I will for sure be buying and playing.
Yeah, I think these look awesome. I love a good board game. So I am fully ready, and I can see Luke's other podcast having quite a few episodes, videos on all of these games.
Totally agreed. So I'm excited to see the release of these. And that is it for the news, my friends.
All right. Well, thank you, Gretchen. Move on to a few announcements this week. We are only one patron away from our next goal, which is longer episodes. So instead of getting just an hour of Hogwarts Radio each week, we will increase our runtime to an hour and a half. This gives you more discussion, more fun, and more of your favorite hosts. Can you help us get there? Sign up over at patreon.com/Hogwarts Radio to get started today. And our last announcement is just a welcome to those of you who have just found the podcast. Over the past few weeks, we've noticed a sizable, consistent spike in our download numbers, and we'd just like to thank you for listening, and we really hope that you're enjoying the show. So after you finish the series, after you finish reading, after you finish consuming the books, most of us devour the books, and, you know, let's say this is our, I don't know, first reread. And I've seen this online, like, people are reading the series for the first time, and they finish, and they're like, oh my god, what do I do with myself now? Well, today we have just a few ways to be able to cope with your post-Potter depression. So the first way, and most obvious one right now, which you're probably listening to our show because of, is listening to Harry Potter podcasts, right? Relive the magic with other passionate Harry Potter fans. You can, which leads to going to conventions, reading fanfics, visiting fan sites, all that other stuff. I mean, there's so much you could do. Like, it's not contained to just the books, and it boggles my mind that there's even people now that have barely heard of Harry Potter fan sites or Harry Potter podcasts or Harry Potter fan conventions and stuff like that. There's so much stuff that you can do.
I think the first thing you should do after you finish the books for the first time is you should pick up Sorcerer's Stone, read it again, read them all again, because there's so much you missed and there's so much you didn't realize tied together, and then start listening to podcasts because you'll appreciate them so much more. But I guess you can start listening to podcasts right away. That's fine. Like, pick up Hogwarts Radio too. But you'll really you really want to read them twice. You really do. That's my two cents.
Yeah, just live in a constant state of rereading the books always. That's basically what I strive to do. But it's totally funny that you should mention listening to Potter podcasts, because after the final Harry Potter movie came out, I felt like I was never going to have enough Harry Potter in my life again. And there was always going to be something missing. And that's how I found Hogwarts Radio, which led to me listening to it, which led to me transcribing for the show, which eventually led to being a host on the show. And now I get to talk about Harry Potter every week with some of my best friends. So it's a win-win-win.
I'm curious, what did everybody do after they finished the series? Did you feel like, oh my God, I have to know more? Like, there were so many unanswered questions. I'm really curious to hear what everybody did as soon as they finished.
So what was interesting was when I first got into the series, I think, Terrence, you had mentioned this previously, that you were similar in that you weren't really exposed to Harry Potter until Goblet of Fire came out. I was in the same boat. And so I got the books on tape because I had really bad dyslexia as a kid, so I wasn't a strong reader. So my mom got me the books on tape and she got me Goblet of Fire. So I started there. And then I went in reverse order. And then I was like, oh, that was actually really good. I don't know if I understood everything. I'm going to start with Sorcerer's Stone and then work my way all the way back up to Goblet of Fire. And so when I actually finished the series, I had this weird moment of like, maybe I should just go in reverse order again. And so I did, like the true dyslexic I am. And so I started from Deathly Hallows and I worked my way all the way back. In terms of like having like a void or like questions I needed answered, I am one of those content, happy fans who will take the information that's given and just mull it over. I'm not going to like throw the book where the epilogue ends and I'm like, I need to know more. I will say though, after the last, it more sunk in for me after the last film, because at least when the last, when Deathly Hallows came out as a book, I was like, cool, we still got films. We're going to be fine. When the last film came out, I had just moved to Chicago to start law school and I didn't know anyone. I was living there by myself and I went to the movie theaters by myself and I saw it by myself and I'm sitting in the law library at school and I'm like, oh my God, what do? I'm a lonely 1L without Harry Potter anymore. And so I definitely had like a big existential crisis, but then I just went and picked up Sorcerer's Stone. So I guess the ultimate conclusion is when you're feeling lonely, just start over.
After I finished the series, I think I cried for like 3 or 4 days straight after that. I mean, that the journey was over in the books, but little did I know the journey had just begun for me, and as far as being a Harry Potter content creator in the fandom. I simply put, I didn't know what the hell to do. Like, I listened to podcasts and stuff like that. I visited the fan sites. I read fan fictions. I was going to conventions and stuff. I didn't get my fill from the books. Like, I had to experience more. And then I started a little podcast. And lo and behold, 11 years later, here we are. Still talking about Harry Potter. Still reliving the magic. Still talking about those 7 books. And it's crazy. And now it's expanded even more. Now we have theme parks. Now we have an entirely new film series out of the franchise. So it's like, oh my gosh, I got into this world after I closed that book. It's just like the roller coaster just kept going. It didn't stop at all. And gosh, it's not going to stop for me, at least for a long time.
I was just going to say, can I also throw in, not totally like cathartic or giving you so much closure, but as I have shown to some of our Patreon subscribers on our Slack chat, I recently invested, or I didn't invest, it was gifted to me, the Harry Potter castle Lego set, the epic 6,000 pieces that I have been working on for quite some time. Mm-hmm. I'm only, I think, 20 bags in out of 40. but every night I do a little bit. But no, and on like a genuine point, what's nice about it is there's so much attention to detail that like you're installing little bits and you're like, oh my God, I remember this bit of information from the books or the films or stuff like that. So if you're a Harry Potter fan and you also love Legos or you want to get into Legos, highly recommend it. It's great therapy.
I have every single set of the new Harry Potter Legos except for that massive castle one sitting in my closet just waiting to be started.
Have you not built them? I like had to rip them open like a small child and be like, wow, we're doing this right now.
I don't have any space to put them once they're finished yet, so that's been my only drawback right now.
Yeah, I don't have a kitchen table anymore because of ours. But I mean, it's a mixture of Disney Legos and Harry Potter Legos. It's actually pretty cool whenever they have to battle each other and stuff. It's real neat to play.
I'd love to hear from someone who read the whole series after it was already published, because I feel like it's such a different experience to start it when the books are still coming out. Because I know for me, I started, I think, right after the fifth one had been released. So I still had the sixth and seventh to go to the midnight parties and to really be immersed in the speculation and to have things spoiled for me, which is so fun. So, you know, I vividly remember like going on forums and writing fan fiction and listening to MuggleCast and, you know, being immersed in the fandom as things were coming out, and then still kind of having that fandom to speculate with and to go through having it be over with. I think that's a very different experience, I'm guessing, than picking up the books, say, 5 years ago and being like, I'm just going to read all these books and falling in love with them that way. So I'd love to hear from someone who has read them all after they're published and kind of hearing how they deal with finishing the series and what they do next. I think that would be interesting.
Let's move on to another question we have, and this is more of a theory, but this is a theory that's floating around online right now, and it says the reason that Harry didn't become an Obscurial whilst living with the Dursleys is because the love of his mother's sacrifice still ran through his veins. This is something to get lost in, and I just don't want us to go down the rabbit hole with, but who has thoughts about this?
So I don't really understand the whole Obscurial thing. Kids who grow up in the wizarding world, they use magic somewhat incidentally, right? And like, didn't Neville not really show any magical prowess until he was like 10 or something, or 8? So I guess I don't understand how you could become an Obscurial just by not really accessing your magic.
Well, and that's, I kind of went poking around when I saw this question posed, and something that I had seen across the forums was that it wasn't so much about not being able to use your magic, but the trauma around like suppressing your magical abilities, which, man, Joe, you are next level with your storytelling analysis. I gotta hand it to you. And so I think that to me was portrayed really vividly and really well, I think, in Fantastic Beasts. You got that clear angst and tension and resentment from Credence about wanting to be a wizard, but also living in this world where it was sinful. I tend to buy into that, and there will probably be a lot of people who at me and they're like, nope, this is, you know, that's not the end all be all, and I welcome that discussion. But for me, that's a pretty satisfying answer.
That's interesting, though, because I feel like there were a couple moments where Harry did have to suppress his magic. Like he ended up on the roof or whatever when he was getting in trouble, and then she cut his hair, Aunt Petunia, and then it grew back and she's trying to cut it again. But maybe it was not so much about suppressing his magic. It was more about, you know, not knowing what was going on. He didn't know it was magic, so it didn't bring about any trauma because he wasn't actively trying to suppress it. So I think that kind of supports what you're saying.
The entire Obscurial concept, I think, is just very mysterious and confusing, and I think it's supposed to be that way. Joe doesn't want us to know everything there is to know about Obscurials yet, partially just for the fact that the Fantastic Beasts franchise, I think, is going to be how we learn more about it.
Yeah, it's like one of those questions we're always going to have, right? I mean, it's one of those things that isn't meant to be answered, much as the veil will never be answered. I really don't think, like, I mean, its purpose that it serves, yada yada, all that stuff that we had talked about in the past. But I mean Harry wasn't aware that he was magical, and it wasn't like, yeah, he was trying to suppress it, because obviously he couldn't. How can you suppress something that you, or how can you control something that you don't know that you have stuff? So I mean very, very interesting. The topic of Obscurus and Obscurials, I'm sure we'll dive into it on a future episode while we wait our 3 years for Fantastic Beasts 3. So what exactly were the dungeons at Hogwarts used for? Dungeons are used to keep people in, not entirely used for torture, although we'll talk about that here in a minute. So could Hogwarts have housed some sort of magical beast? Is this where Daenerys Targaryen kept their dragons? Or did Slytherin just want them for aesthetic?
What good is a castle without a dungeon, Terrence?
Yeah, but dungeons are to be used. I mean, essentially a castle is like a, you know, it's like the center of town. It's like the big thing. It's like the big house in the middle of town. Well, essentially, castle is a little town. I mean, so dungeons are prisons, essentially. And what the heck could they be using prisons for in a school?
Detention.
A magical school.
Detention. Yep, for those bad kids. The only way they'll learn is prison. What's that show called where they, like, scared straight? It's like Scared Straight.
Ladies and gentlemen, the OG version, and the, oh, this is a joke that I'm probably going to eat, but the truest version of the school to prison pipeline is right there. There you go.
Scared straight out of Hogwarts.
And I'd also like to add, as someone who works against the school to prison pipeline, I am not endorsing that at all. I know I'm going to get a ton of flack for that comment. But no, I mean, I thought about, like, what other uses you could have. And, you know, maybe there were some creatures down there, but essentially I just kept hearing Argus Filch in my head when he was describing hanging students by their toenails and how he missed the screaming when I saw this comment. And I should not be laughing, but it's one of his fonder moments in a weird way in the film series. But yeah, I mean, at one point the world believed in, you know, not corporal punishment, but corporal punishment, but also just isolation. And, you know, there's the Breakfast Club version of detention, and then there's the Harry Potter version of detention. And I think that involves some dungeons.
Okay, well, that does wrap up the questions for this week. And before we wrap up today's show, we are going to play Sorting Hat. So this is where we are sorting particular people, celebrities, real life people. Doesn't matter. We sort them into their Hogwarts houses. So today's sorting this music gives me the chills. We're going to be sorting the Avengers into their Hogwarts houses. Now, there's quite a few Avengers, sure, but we're just going to really stick to the main ones. Iron Man, who is Tony Stark. The Hulk, Bruce Banner. Black Widow, who is Natasha Romanoff. Captain America, Steve Rogers. Thor, and Hawkeye. So let's talk about this. I am like, I'm so sad I don't have my camera on right now.
Beep, beep, beep. Great music, Alan Silvestri.
That music just, like, inspires the most epic feeling in me every time I hear it.
It's so good.
This one, yeah, it really gets me going. Like, this one, Pirates of the Caribbean, Jurassic Park, mm-hmm. You know, all of those good ones.
Mm-hmm. I came prepared. I have my Captain Marvel shoes on right now.
Uh-oh. So what about, so let's start off. Okay, Iron Man, Tony Stark, what house would he be placed in?
I thought Slytherin for sure.
Yeah?
Yeah, I could see the Ravenclaw angle on it, but I don't know. I feel like he does have that ambition that while his intellect informs what he does, his ambition is kind of like the overarching goal. I mean, you see it throughout the entire kind of Marvel universe, not just in like in the Avengers and Infinity War and all that, but even in the Iron Man films as well. I don't know. I definitely got a strong Slytherin vibe for Iron Man.
Yeah, he's kind of, I mean, especially early on in him being Iron Man, he was all about himself and making himself look good. And, you know, he was just really consumed with him and he didn't care about anybody else.
Well, and especially even before he becomes Iron Man, just with all of his...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
...vast greed, I guess, in his business, definitely feels like a Slytherin-esque trait. But I think more so once he becomes Iron Man, he leans less towards the Slytherin side and more towards the Ravenclaw side of that.
Very true.
He's a Slytherclaw. It's decided.
What about Hulk, who is Bruce Banner? I would say solid Ravenclaw.
Definitely, all the way.
Yeah. His 12 PhDs, right? And I'm not even exaggerating.
Yeah. What about the Hulk, though?
Oh. Hulk smash. I mean,
Hulk smash. He's Hulk green smash. Like a Slytherin.
Yeah, but there's some quality. Like whenever he is Hulk, you can see like in certain movies, like in Thor 3.
Thor Ragnarok.
Yeah, yeah. You can where you actually see Hulk for like the entire movie. You can see that he has like these longing qualities, these qualities that his human side just kind of takes over every once in a while. And he's able to empathize and sympathize. He's able to kind of show loyalty and all that other stuff. I don't know. Maybe in Hulk form, he's a Gryffindor.
I could see it. Does that make him a Griffin, Lynn?
Oh, God, I hope not.
A Ravendor?
A Ravendor? I'm getting them all mixed up now. Never mind.
Let's talk about Black Widow, who is Natasha Romanoff, played by Scarlett Johansson in the Avengers films. Black Widow, I would say, is a pure Slytherin.
I'd agree. Definitely the spy background leads me to that.
So I actually kind of struggled with it, this one. I mean, my gut was like, oh, yeah, Slytherin. But then, and I am forgetting in which films this really played out, but her loyalty to not only Hawkeye, but also to the Hulk. There was this, even though she has gone rogue in some plot lines and has kind of ventured off to do her own thing, she kind of always returns back to the Avengers, and she has these like glimmers of moments where she just has this undying like loyalty and in her own kind of way, her own like compassion for the group and her own affection towards the group. So that thought kind of percolated for a minute. And so that's where I was kind of like, I don't know, are we just painting her with one broad stroke if we call her just a Slytherin or is a Slytherin? So I actually struggled with this one a little bit.
I think that's what I like about her as a character. I feel like she has a lot of varied layers that come up. She's a spy, but she's also very loyal, like you say. So I think the fact that we can't sort her is maybe a good thing. Shows that she's a pretty three-dimensional character.
Oh, is she a hat stall then?
Maybe.
That's very interesting. Okay, so let's move on to our next one, which is
Mr. Sexy Pants himself.
Sure. Yeah, we're talking about Captain America now. Mr. Steve Rogers, the first Avenger.
I mean, has there ever been a more Gryffindor human in all of existence?
Yeah, I mean, that's a solid yes for me. Gryffindor all the way.
But I also lean strongly towards the Hufflepuff. I can see it. He's very kind and selfless.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So it was funny. I was thinking about this and I was like, oh yeah, duh, he's Gryffindor. Like even when he was like his scrawny 80-pound self, he would like try and run into the fight and just get like little kid face palmed by the enemy. And so I was like, yeah, you go, brave little buddy, you go. But then, and maybe I just wear like Hufflepuff rose-colored glasses on everyone. I'm like, everyone should be a Hufflepuff. Everyone should be loyal and empathetic and love each other. So I'm like, because everyone has a little trait of it. But I am for sure calling dibs on Captain America as the spokeswoman for Hufflepuff. Y'all keep your hands off of Captain America. He's coming to us.
He's a little badger. I dig it. I'm okay with it.
Rawr.
Yeah, okay. No comment, but yeah, Gryffindor through and through. What about Thor? Let's talk about him.
He's a Gryffindor, for sure.
Yeah, he's definitely that, you know, act first, think later, brave Gryffindor type.
Yeah, Terrence, y'all get Thor. You keep Thor, I keep Captain America. You don't have to be greedy and keep everyone. We could share.
I think I'll have to agree with Rabbit over here. Yeah, why not? I'll keep Thor. But I would have to agree that he had to endure a harsh trial to get to the man that he is today. I would say he started out as a Slytherin at the beginning of the first Thor movie, and he went on this incredible spiritual journey and physical journey as well in that first movie, and he just totally flipped 180 and became a Gryffindor at the end, where he was noble, he was brave, he was fighting for the, you know, the common good, and all that stuff. So yeah, I mean, Thor is a Gryffindor. And the last one, the one that always seems to be forgotten, but I really think and I hope to God that he plays an important role in the final Avengers film, is Hawkeye. And let's talk about him. What do we think?
I think Clint Barton is the most undersold Avenger that there is. And I am still upset that he was not in Infinity War. And I think that just means there's going to be a lot of things happening for him in the next film.
Agreed.
I hope so.
And I think he's a full-on Ravenclaw.
Yeah?
Yeah. He's very smart. And just the amount of skill and knowledge that it takes to do archery, I think that... leads itself into it.
I feel like he's very like kind, and he's obviously a team player. And I love that scene with him and Scarlet Witch in the second one, where he kind of like lifts her spirits and helps her realize that she needs to like get out there and fight. That's such a beautiful scene. So I feel like he could be a Hufflepuff.
Agree.
Yeah, I'm not totally sold on the Ravenclaw analysis. The Hufflepuff, I guess I could see, not only for that point, Gretchen, but also we go so many films without even really realizing like he has a family, and that's home base, and that's who he's ultimately loyal to at the end of the day. And that's also a beautiful scene. I love when we learn that side of him, that softer side. I actually kind of have this dueling like diagnosis sorting. Wow. Of either
make it sound like a disease.
A dueling diagnosis, guys. Of Gryffindor or Slytherin. Although now that we're like talking about all these wonderful features of Hawkeye, I'm like, he couldn't be Slytherin. But I would definitely throw in some Gryffindor. In the bravery and kind of just jumping into the fight, he's a little bit more calculated. He's not like Thor or like Hulk smash, but he's definitely like willing to just dive right into it. But there's also some loyalty, and this is where we just, you know, it's not canon, but the BuzzFeed quiz answers a lot of problems in this scenario. I'm just going to put that out there.
I think we can agree to agree Hawkeye is a hat stall.
You know what? He's as close to a hat stall as, gosh, I don't know. Maybe, yeah, no, he's just a hat stall. That's it. There's nothing else to say about that. That's an easy way out of it, I feel like. Oh, we can't sort him. He's a hat stall. But, okay, well, that's how we do it. That's how we sort the Avengers. There's no theme music to go along with this, guys, because you know what? Our theme music is in right now. For those of you listening to the show, thank you so much for all of your support. And hey, a big thank you to our patrons who are in our hangout listening to us record this episode live right now. So we definitely appreciate your support as well. And shout out to Tyler, who suddenly dropped in the call a little bit ago and was listening and tweeting along live. So thank you, Tyler. Tyler will be back either next week or the week after as soon as we work out some more details on next week's episode. But for now, that's all we have for you on this fun Hulk Smash, Hogwarts Radio Smash episode of our Harry Potter podcast. I'm Terrence Pinkston.
I'm Bailey Riddle.
I'm Gretchen Rush.
And I'm Alex Lohman.
And we'll see you next time for episode 236. 100. Jeez, I'm crow. I'm just
taking it way into the past.
I'm either 100. I'm 100 years ahead or I'm 100 episodes behind. Bye-bye.
That was bloody brilliant.
Codswallop.